Okay, well, we've got some preliminaries, so we'll go ahead and get going to be respectful of folks' time. I want to thank people for attending today, and especially thank my fellow panelists for making time for this. Again, welcome to folks from our whole college community, and we are doing this today in honor of Constitution Day. Every year, Thursday, September 17th, a Constitution Day, which was a day of recognition created by the federal government, may be interesting to think about in this context. And it happens to be the case that all institutions that receive federal financial aid are obliged to offer some educational program each year in honor of Constitution Day. And so we do that in various ways, a lecture, seminar, panel discussion, and I don't think many of us think it's much of an obligation. It's an honor and opportunity to think about something in relation to the Constitution each year. So we often try to do things that seem timely in some fashion. The Supreme Court case today, Grutter v. Bollinger, that we're taking as our point of departure relates to diversity and racial diversity in higher education, and that seemed timely given the national ferment and debates in our country today. I think it's worth noting about the program at St. John's. We certainly think of our seminars typically being on great books, but there's a strong tradition of devoting any number of seminars in the senior year, right at the close of the program, to Supreme Court opinions. And that's varied over the years and decades. My own sense from experience, I did a little bit of research on this today, is at its peak, that meant something like 5 consecutive seminars on nothing but Supreme Court opinions in the very last weeks of the senior year. I think that it's at least the peak that I'm aware of was in the 90s at some time. And in doing that research, I actually found that for a few years, the Bakke case that is the background for this one was read in the senior seminar, either the next to last seminar or before that. But I bring all that up to say that I think it highlights the aspect of the program that is eloquently captured in a few sentences, in the statement of the program and the mission statement of the college, about preparation for citizenship and for making reasoned and effective choices in public and private life. And it's good when we get an opportunity to read and think about these cases. And I think it's deep in the tradition of the college. And we haven't shied away from controversial decisions. When I was a student and in the years I led senior seminars, we would read Roe v. Wade, for example. And I think of that as paradigmatically one of the most divisive, politically divisive, actively divisive opinions. And so it's a tribute to our students in our classroom that we can have effective and reasoned conversations about things that highlight so much political disagreements. So I've got a nice, good and generous panel of colleagues here. Members of faculty and staff on both campuses. And I'm gonna let each of them introduce themselves. But what we're gonna do is go around and just hear for a couple of minutes from each panelist. And really what I invite each of us to do is just offer any reflections that were prompted by reading this case in the context of perhaps how you think about your work as an educator or leader in higher education, or how you think about this case in relation to what you see in education or in your own experience more broadly, or in connection to the debates of the moment. So really whatever each of us wants to say, stimulated by thinking about this. After we do that, we'll have a little bit of conversation amongst ourselves, and then very quickly we'll open it up for questions and comments from those who are attending. I think with that, I guess I was saying to the panelists, maybe I'd just say for people who are just tuning in with no context at all, this this case and this ruling and opinion from 2003 is the law of the land governing considerations of race, specifically in higher education admissions. And that's what's at issue. It relates, you could say, to the category of affirmative action. It relates to questions about quotas and other more mechanical ways of determining the racial profile of student bodies. But the case is about the race-conscious admissions of the University of Michigan Law School at the time, and it really sets the parameters that we're all still working within across higher education. And I will note that Benjamin Baum, who's on the call today, and you received these in the advanced materials, had published a couple of opinion pieces on more recent rulings, and he might have things to say about that in the discussion. But the Fisher v. cases are the most recent Supreme Court opinions in this thread, and they continue, as I understand it, they continue to hold to the Grutter framework that O'Connor laid out under continued challenges. So that's just a little bit of context. And with that, I'm going to just sort of move around the panel. And Ben, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and get us started. And don't forget to introduce yourself, what you do at the college, and anything else. And then a couple of minutes of reflections.
Sure. So hello, everyone. I'm Ben Baum. I'm Vice President of Enrollment and based on the Annapolis campus, but I oversee admissions and financial aid on both campuses. And I come at this, from an unusual standpoint. On the one hand, I actually was admitted to the University of Michigan Law School in 2003, when this case came out. And on the other hand, I work in admissions where I've in fact employed race-conscious affirmative action. And so I think I come at this case thinking about both of those things. And my vantage point as a result is I'm really interested in certain aspects of this case, and there's so many facets to talk about. But the first instinct I have when I read this case is to think about what is the definition of merit? I mean, how are we deciding who we are admitting to our colleges? And that's not necessarily the main thrust of what most of these thoughts from the various justices are about. I see this conversation come up in the course of the question of what is narrowly tailored. And so the standard in this case was the strict scrutiny standard, where we needed to see that there was a compelling interest that the University of Michigan had, and that it was narrowly tailored, the methods used to achieve that compelling interest. And so this question of merit is really about that second piece of that, about how narrowly tailored were the tools being used to achieve the educational benefits that might come from diversity. And there's a lot of discussion in what Justice O'Connor writes about when it comes to race neutral alternatives. What has the University of Michigan shown it tried or thought about that could be used instead of race-conscious admissions? That would be a question of whether it's narrowly tailored. And so these tools are really about what it means, what merit is, who deserves to be admitted to the college, or in this case, the law school. And yet she kind of skips over that question, the depth of what it merit would be. And you only start getting into that question when you read some of the dissents. And so when you read Justice Thomas' dissent, when you read Justice Kennedy's dissent, they're talking about that their idea is that this is in fact not narrowly tailored, that in fact too much deference was being given by Justice O'Connor to the University of Michigan on the assumption that the University of Michigan had tried all these other tools, all these race neutral tools, and instead they would use a race conscious one because that was the only tool that would work for their purposes. But you read Justice Kennedy. Justice Kennedy, I think, calls Justice O'Connor's opinion on this perfunctory. He seems to think that she didn't really go into challenging the University of Michigan on this question of did they try race-neutral alternatives. And Justice Thomas gets into this question, which I think is just fascinating, about the LSAT. So the standardized test used for admission at the University of Michigan, like the SAT, but for law schools. Justice Thomas, I think, has this really interesting line where he tells us that there's no modern law school can claim ignorance of the poor performance of Blacks, relatively speaking, on the LSAT. Nevertheless, law schools continue to use the test and then attempt to correct for Black underperformance by using racial discrimination in admissions so as to obtain the student body they're seeking. And I think that's, I don't necessarily agree with what Thomas has said there, but I think this is a really interesting question in the practice of admissions. Has the University of Michigan set itself up to need to use affirmative action, race-conscious affirmative action, because the merit, the standards the University of Michigan is using to do it, creates a difference in outcomes based on race? And so if we know the LSAT, for whatever reason, results in lower scores for one racial group and higher scores for another racial group, why doesn't the University of Michigan stop using the LSAT and instead use some other form of merit to determine who it's going to admit? I think that question of why is something we can chat about in the course of this conversation, but I find that really interesting, and that those are the kinds of things I need to reflect about in my own job. What are we weighing as merit? Who are we choosing to admit to the college? And are decisions about merit actually causing us to employ different tools like race-conscious affirmative action as a result? So those are just some initial thoughts of mine on the topic.
Thank you so much, Ben. I think we're going to move to Martha Franks next.
Thank you, Walter. My name is Martha Franks. I'm a visiting tutor on the Santa Fe campus. And I've just been named to the admissions committee. So I guess I'll have some further thoughts about all of this as applied. I'm also a practicing attorney, and I've been practicing law for 30 years, including some cases in front of the United States Supreme Court. And I guess that what really struck me as I read through this case, maybe a little bit of a sideline, but maybe it will be helpful to people to think about how the court works and how the court thrashes out constitutional issues, because it seemed to me that the majority and the variety of, and Ben is right, even abrasive dissents, are reflect a tension that has been in the Constitution from the beginning. That in the preamble, the very first purpose listed in the Constitution is, we the people of the United States of America, in order to form a more perfect union. It's a corporate goal, and it's directly related to citizenship and the issues of citizenship that rise in the Guttner case. So on the basis of that preamble, you might say, well, obviously, diversity, insofar as it improves the way people will be citizens in an increasingly diverse country and world, of course, is a compelling state interest. Almost immediately after the Constitution was ratified, the Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments were added. And then, of course, what's at issue in this case is the 14th Amendment, which O'Connor remarks is directed to persons, not groups. The Bill of Rights and the certainly the 13th and 14th Amendments are generally thought to be protecting individual concerns. So you have in the Bill of Rights all the stuff about search and seizure and, you know, presumptions of innocence and due process and all the things that make an individual person feel comfortable from government overreach and fairly treated. So I was interested in what Mr. Baum said, because I'm not sure that merit is at the heart of this. Merit seems like a matter of the things from the individual's point of view, that the only way that an individual can get fair treatment is if merit is the only standard. But it seemed to me that the case was about a more corporate sense of citizenship, that the law school had a duty to provide an education that will improve citizenship by permitting an experience of diversity. And that has nothing to do with individual merit. So for me, I'm just noted the way this case seems to divide along the lines of that constitutional difference in emphasis between the original document characterized by the preamble on the one hand, and the amendments added almost immediately, but in a separate process on the other hand, that we are always, the justices in interpreting the Constitution are looking at the different emphases between the United States of America trying to form a more perfect union and the United States of America protecting and treating its citizens fairly. And this case seemed to me to display that concern. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Franks. Mr. Bleichmar.
Yes, hi, my name is Guillermo Bleichmar. I'm a tutor in Santa Fe. And I'm also in the admissions committee. So I read files of students and I rank them. So these questions are alive for me there. And I guess I'll add that I was an international student. I grew up in Latin America. So I've experienced that as a student in different ways. I'm now in the process of becoming a US citizen. So I'm very curious about all kinds of questions about the Constitution that I've never explored. But you know, as a tutor, my main concern is the classroom and the intellectual life of the students. And so what I most deeply care about is what's gonna make for an environment that's gonna make people fall in love with the books we read, fall in love with the idea of reading them together, want to continue to do that beyond their 4 years here and so on. And then, so the issue of how diversity affects that, you know, how it its educational impact, its human impact, was what I was mostly interested in the case. And I'm less knowledgeable about the legal technicalities, which I found fascinating as well. And so in that sense, I'll just say briefly that what most struck me sort of big picture was, on the one hand, the opinion that that there are sort of invaluable educational and civic benefits to diversity, as made by O'Connor. And then I thought pushed even harder by Ginsburg beyond education, but into sort of like the life of citizenship. And then what I took, and then I was very interested in Thomas's opinion, and especially what I thought was maybe, to my mind, the most challenging and perhaps the darkest view of the matter, when he says that heterogeneity actually impairs the learning of minorities. I thought that was that's something I want to sort of try to think about and wrestle with, because I think what I was wondering is, if we want to attain these educational and human benefits, if we determine that diversity is conducive to them, then it seems like you have the additional problem of how to avoid all the problems that come with a program of affirmative action that, at least in Thomas's view, could lead to deleterious outcomes. So I found that that kind of stuck with me as something very difficult to process, and something that I think I would like to disprove. And so for me, the question becomes a little bit, how would we do that as a community? I think that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Quintana.
Hi, everyone. My name is Piér Quintana. I'm the Assistant Director of the Office of Personal and Professional Development in Santa Fe. And I also want to share that I'm a governing board member for Santa Fe Community College, which is an open access institution, which does not use or employ selective admission. So I share that because I think it's important when looking at affirmative action. Gosh, so much has already been said that is so important in terms of thinking about the case that we just read. One of the things, I listened to the arguments that were available, and one of the things that kept coming up before I even read the case was this idea that in 25 years, we may not have a need for this. And it was said again in O'Connor's support of their decision. We're coming on 18 years now, and we're in the midst of a racial reckoning, right? Where this is still very much a part of something that we need to be considering, and we're not close to it being something that won't be considered in admissions any longer, right? We have so many systemic challenges within our society that we need to address before I think we can fully move forward. But in Justice Thomas's dissent, one of the things that I found interesting was it's almost as if he gets at the heart of some of those systemic racist issues that live within selective higher ed admissions. And I think it goes back to the question of merit. So to Mr. Baum's point of the LSAT in and of itself is indicative of some of the challenges that racial minorities experience. They're not able to perform as well because maybe the way the test is structured or preparation that folks can get if they're coming from Black or Hispanic background, so to speak. So I guess there are so many questions around this, but really how the dissent, I don't think it really is going at the individual and how are we evaluating their merit or their performance. So anyhow, I have more questions than I have answers. and so I'm really looking forward to this conversation because I wouldn't say this is an area of expertise for me, but it is an area that I am very passionate about and that I care very deeply about in terms of making sure that all students have equal access to quality education. But also I'm curious in terms of how selective admissions limits certain students from being able to participate in certain types of institutions or programs of study. So anyhow, thank you.
Thank you, Piér. Cesar Cervantes.
Thanks, Walter. Hello, everyone. I'm Cesar Cervantes. I'm the Director of Student Life here in Santa Fe. And a little more context is I, as an undergrad, I went to a Hispanic serving institution. I started working there as an RA in Student Life, and I literally have not left Student Life since. And so, a couple of previous roles before joining the Johnny team here, I was at United World College as the Dean of Residential Life and Experiential Education. And then before that, as the Assistant Dean of Students at Colorado College. And I mention that because, all three of these communities are very different. But the consistency, I think, is that we're all trying to develop and build a meaningful, healthy community that serves the mission of the college. And so I just want to say, I think the case certainly is influential, affirming, important in the work that I do in student life. I think certainly in some ways it's incomplete in the sense that there is also a matter of justice that isn't part of the argument. The sort of 25 year span, I think I also feel is problematic. I think that performance markers make more sense, and perhaps a call for congressional action and looking at K through 12 is all part of resolution, solution, work, et cetera. But what I wanted to just quickly focus on from a student life perspective as I read into the case, and what resonates most with me is this the emphasis and language about critical mass or meaningful representation, which essentially is a number that encourages underrepresented or minoritized students to participate and engage in and out of the classroom, and so that they're not isolated or in a position to speak for their entire race. Another effect of achieving meaningful representation is that it causes racial stereotypes to lose their force, right? So what happens is that students learn that there is no collective minoritized voice, but rather a spectrum of viewpoints among minoritized students. The importance of this meaningful representation is true, I think, in all aspects of student life. So for students to be able to be fully engaged and develop as college students, there's an importance in the residence and programming and leadership, you know, all facets. We also know that students connecting with their peers and having peer-to-peer support is a really strong indicator of student success. And so this meaningful representation, again, plays an integral part of these relationships. Also, I think we can look towards student development theory to affirm this. And so when we talk about challenge versus support, or building a community that is conducive to identity development, again, this is in some support of meaningful representation. And I think the last thing that I'll note is that, when we bring it back to our community and part of the St. John's mission, I don't think we can hope to free ourselves of prejudice without meaningful representation. Thank you.
Thank you, Cesar. And now Caroline Randall.
Thank you so much. So I'm Caroline Randall. I'm Director of Admissions on the Santa Fe campus. And I do not have a legal background, so did not approach this case with that mindset. I have quite a few years in admissions, and I have worked for a medium-sized state school where the idea of merit was how well you could win a football game, usually came into play with the admission decision more than anything else. Also very cut and dry GPA test scores. We looked at nothing else. I've worked at a small private regional school that struggled to attract students. And so we did a holistic approach, but again, test scores and GPA still weighed heavily above all else. And we were and became a Hispanic serving institution, but then also within our efforts pushed too far in one direction and became unbalanced again. And as I read this case and in my year at St. John's, really what this came down to was we absolutely have to have diversity at our colleges. You know, Cesar does a great job of explaining the different student theories behind what we need in our classrooms, but we have to learn how to work with people who are different than us and understand people who are different from us. So around the seminar table, we absolutely have to have diversity of background, diversity of thought. All of that has to come into play. Where I think I really see the challenges is that none of this can just be a blanket approach. We cannot just say all colleges now need a holistic approach, because that doesn't always work for some colleges. And each college has to determine what their critical mass is or what their balance is. You know, if I pick on the service academies, for many years they didn't let women in. And then when they did, they still really only attracted men. And so they had to find a balance to work specifically on gender, and then they worked specifically on race. And so each school has to look and see what their balance is. So when you factor in a holistic formula, then you come into play with merit that we've talked about already, of how do you determine that merit and how are you trying to find that balance at your school? And it opens the door for a lot of mistakes and a lot of things that colleges are doing wrong. And for one, it's focusing on implicit bias of the readers, that the admissions readers may not agree with the need to bring in certain types of diversity into the college and may have implicit bias when they read applications. Then it also requires colleges to assess their application process every single year. They need to determine where their balance is, and that balance is going to change every single year. And one of the things that most colleges do not do well is change, and we don't do change fast. And so the idea of completely restructuring our admission decision every single year becomes an impossible ask for a lot of colleges. And so when I read this case and I read about the need to have this holistic review and to balance and give bonus points to certain areas, it becomes really challenging to say who is doing this right and who's doing this wrong, and to truly end up finding balance at the end of the day. And so I think that that has been where my biggest struggle is in my own work in admissions. And then also as I look at this case and determine what is the right answer. And I'm not sure we have come to it. I know that our colleges are not diverse enough. And I know that there are things like the LSAT and the SAT and the fact that calculus isn't offered in certain socioeconomic areas. And we are doing things wrong in our K through 12 that are setting us up for failure at the college level and beyond. And so trying to figure out where that solution is really, really taxing on my brain. So that is the position I'm coming at tonight.
Thank you. Thank you. I'll make just a couple of comments before we start to move around. I remember when this case was decided, it really felt like a dramatic moment, and it was much awaited at the time. I think, you know, I'm trying to present this in a fairly objective way. It was perceived as an opportunity from the conservative side to continue to chip away at the legacy of affirmative action and to move towards an ideal of race neutrality. And I think there was optimism on that side that the conservative bloc would strike this down. And there was a great deal of anticipation about what O'Connor, as the first female Supreme Court justice, and Thomas, as not the first, but at that time the only African-American on the court, what role they might have in that. And so for O'Connor as a conservative justice to become the swing vote and then write this eloquent majority opinion really seemed quite momentous. And then the fact that it's Thomas that writes the memorable and scathing and extended critique, that all just seemed like high drama and sort of epoch marking, at least at that time for the court. The other perception that I have, not based, I'm definitely not a legal scholar, and this is really just one person's perception, but it seemed to me to map on to a moment or a time where the discourse shifted from affirmative action to language of diversity, and that language becoming really very broadly held values that seem to rise out of the partisan political debate to a great extent, right? We're looking at a 5-4 decision here, and one that continues to fall right along the fault lines of the Supreme Court. So I'm not saying by any means that the political questions were answered, but to my sort of 30,000 foot view, it's no accident that you have a case like this in 2003, and you have a college like St. John's produce its first diversity statement, right, under that rubric in 2007, affirming the positive value of diversity as essential to our education in a way that hadn't been framed that way before. And I think in that sense, we were part of a shifting national discourse and so on. I myself find O'Connor's opinion quite eloquent, and you might say in a way the digression on, it's not a digression, it's essential to the argument, but the digression on diversity as, in terms of the legal argument, as a compelling government or state interest, but really the essentiality, the essential character of diversity for higher education to achieve the aims it aims at, seems to me to be a great statement of public policy at this time in our national history that, again, I think kind of rises out of the case and captures broader, largely national consensus in higher education in many respects, I think. So that said, I think there are many interesting arguments and debates in here, and I'm not even particularly taking a position on the constitutional question, but just how influential the perception or the experience of the value of racial and other forms of diversity in higher education had become at this time, that it bubbled through and really decided this case, and I think shifted in some ways the framework for how higher education was able to start to articulate its own consciousness of how it tried to work with these issues. So those are some thoughts I have after reading it and kind of thinking about the arc from 2003 to the present. You know, I think with that, I'm just looking at the time, and with the panelists' indulgence, I might suggest we go ahead and open it up to questions and comments from the audience. And we can, doesn't keep us from responding to one another, but I'd love to go ahead and do that. And I see one question has already popped up, and just let me say to our audience members, you can write a question or comment in the Q&A box that you can open. You could also, through the chat thread, type a question or comment that the panelist will see. And especially, I'd encourage people to raise their hand and we can unmute you and take some live voice questions. Happy to do it anyway, okay? So the first question we have here, isn't the most important criterion for admitting a student to the college, the student's ability to do the work of the program successfully? Is such a criterion a misguided issue of merit? And I don't know if, in some ways that might connect most directly to where Ben started us, but I don't know if anybody wants to go right at that one. I certainly have some thoughts, but I wanna risk just defaulting to myself here.
Maybe I could start just by saying, so there's a question maybe specifically about St. John's there, but then there's a broader question. And then maybe I'll start with the broader question. This is the question, what should we weigh in determining who to admit? Not we as a college, but we as any college. What are those things that we consider the most important? And you have to couch that, at least in this situation, in the University of Michigan's case, in that question of selectivity. I was just looking, and I don't know the answer to this definitively, but I could not find in the case the percentage of students who were admitted to the University of Michigan Law School. I'm not sure it's mentioned anywhere in the case, which is a bizarre thing, because at its core, the issue here is that you have too many people applying for too few spots. And the University of Michigan's decided how many spots are going to be there, so that might be one question, but there are too many people applying to too few spots. And so how are you going to determine which ones of those should be admitted? And every college has to come up with their own answer to that question. It could be, in the case of the University of Michigan, it's an LSAT score. That's what they care about most. And if you do that, then there are going to be multiple consequences. There'll be great students, perhaps, for the University of Michigan that are missed, because while they didn't show their merit on the basis of an LSAT score, they could have shown it on the basis of something else. And so that, I think, is kind of at the heart of all of this question, is selectivity, too many spots, too few spots for too many people. So how do we determine who we should admit? And it's possible, in the case of St. John's, we could say the ability to do the work of the program, that is the primary metric we want to use to determine merit for admission. That may work, but what if that metric means that there are still too few spots for the number of people who have earned that merit? We have to continue to find a way to admit students to the number of spots we have. That's the beginning of this question and a broader way of thinking about it.
Does anybody else on the panel want to add to that?
I will just speak from my own struggles at St. John's. If we somewhat narrowly, and I use that term loosely, define that a student could come here and do the program, that can be very difficult to determine who can come here and do the program and be successful. And I think at any college, you can see a student that checks every single box, whatever those are, that looks like they will be absolutely perfect and they start in the program, and they're not. There's all different factors that can come into that. And so as I think about St. John's, there's this automatic idea of, well, anybody who has done a Great Books program in K through 12, anybody who's gone to, like, let's say a Great Heart School or areas like that where they've already had all this exposure to it, they know all about the Great Books, they are ready for it, they're excited for it, well then great, let's bring them in the door. But there's also this whole world of individuals that have never known anything like St. John's. Nothing in their K through 12 was geared towards this. They didn't even know that this was a possibility. They were always the book nerd in the back of class or whatever, and they never felt like they belonged, but they didn't realize this was an opportunity. So if I just look at their application and look at their merit, whatever that is, of their ability to do the program, at this point, they may not have shown me anything that is their ability to do the program, but there's other factors that we can look into and see potential in the student. And so that's where the diversity of thought comes into play. If we only bring in students who have done Great Books programs, then we fail in bringing good diversity of thought at times. And so that's where I've struggled to not just look at certain factors in our admissions policies at St. John's.
And I would add to that diversity of thought, but also diversity of experience. I mean, for instance, I've had students over the past 10 years who are not academically stellar. For instance, older students who haven't written for a long time and can't write a very good essay, and on a kind of like pure meritocracy of writing, you know, test scores, GPA, you might think, well, this person won't do the program as well as this other person. And yet because of the kind of experiences they'd had, I thought they made very important contributions to texts that in a way experientially are beyond any undergraduate. So I would add that experience can help someone do aspects of the program that don't always correspond to pure intellectual power.
I want to add too that, and I think this is in agreement with what's been said, but coming from a different angle, we also want to think about the work of the college. And what exactly that is. If the work of the college is to make free people through books, then we do the work of the college better when there's a whole variety of students here. So insofar as one might begin by saying, oh, well, what we're saying is we need a floor of talent, that may not be right, or at least that may not be where we want to end up. Because what we're trying to create possibly is good and important conversation that will free people's minds. That's the work of the college. And for that, it may be absolutely essential to have a heterogeneous student body.
I think what I'd like to contribute as well is that the question seems to want to put the program in a vacuum, right? And so if we look at students that leave or withdraw, they were not able to complete the program, but it wasn't necessarily because they were not up to the challenge of the rigor of the program. For example, there could be mental health issues, there could be they weren't able to connect with their peer group. And these are, these are common reasons. And so it can and certainly does go back to sort of having meaningful representation for many students.
I'm just gonna add, maybe looking right at the language of the question, is the most important criterion the student's ability? I don't want to exaggerate this, though I think some of our faculty do, including our most legendary faculty member, Eva Brand, who likes to say selectivity has always been and should always be a bad word at the college. I mean, certainly going back to my student days when I worked in admissions, the language that that I heard then, maybe more strongly even than I hear now, is that interest, serious interest and desire to undertake what we do is what we think of as the most important criterion. And it would be possible to become more and more selective in the name of trying to get students who have the greatest ability construed as, you know, who's going to have no problems with calculus, no problems with working through an argument in Kant and so on. But the college has always resisted that, I think, to its credit, maybe at some risk, by being, you know, very open to bringing in students who have a passion for this, understanding that they might not be as well equipped as they need to be. And then we try to help them. But I do think the college has resisted the idea that those in whom we have the most confidence in their intellectual ability or background, that that's the group we're aiming at. I think the emphasis we put on essays over the years at the expense of test scores has been part of that. And again, the pendulum needs to swing. You can go too far in different directions. But I continue to think that we think most students, if they're really passionate about this, really want it for the deep values that it articulates, that's gonna overcome a lot. It can overcome a lot in terms of a sheer intellectual ability or preparation as reflected in GPA and test scores. The next question, kind of a challenge to us, I think. How can there be an open-minded examination of this question given the fact that no one on the panel is opposed to diversity as a goal and to affirmative action as a policy? So again, I've thoughts about that. I don't know that that's true exactly of the panel, but does anybody have any thoughts about?
Well, yeah, I think I have to cop to thinking that that to not being opposed to diversity as a goal. I think that's probably, I just do believe that. I think that is part of what it means to free a mind. I do want to say, though, that the particular issue of the 25 years that the case raises challenged me in this way, that the court can't possibly believe that after 25 years, diversity is going to go away or cease to be valuable. So the court must be suggesting that after 25 years, there'll be no more racism, that this specific kind of diversity will no longer be an issue. And I thought to myself, well, maybe I'm sort of leaning toward Justice Thomas on that. It's like, really? Do we want not to have preserved identities? Is that what we're shooting for? That nobody will identify with their race, white or black or whatever? In answer to this question, as I've been reflecting on this question, I've been trying to sort out what the court meant by saying in 25 years, we won't have to think about diversity.
I appreciate the question. I think I would answer that by saying that, essentially what the question might be asking is, why isn't there anyone on the panel who, as I would interpret it, opposes the mission of the college? And I think that perhaps that wouldn't be a good fit for us to be in this place if we were in opposition of the mission of the college.
Well, I'm not sure that I want to, on behalf of the questioner, think about that a little bit, because Thomas has a really interesting argument about historically black colleges and making the point that that maybe there are people who are more comfortable and better served, and their minds might be freed more easily without having to serve as some sort of, you know, diversity witness about their previous experience, which is related to the point you were making, Mr. Cervantes, that you don't want anybody to feel like they're a token. So it's not altogether clear cut for me.
I think that's fair.
I'll again, if any of the other panelists interrupt me at your leisure, because I always get my say sooner or later. But I guess I challenge a couple of the premises of the question. I'm not sure in this context that I think of diversity as a goal as opposed to a means. You know, if I think about analogous cases, I think at the college, many of us think, to take another kind of example, but I actually think it's the same kind of example as what's at stake in the case, that it's very important that we have liberals and conservatives among our students and faculty. It's important that we have religious believers and believers of different faiths and non-believers. Do I think that that diversity is an end in itself, that that's the end? I don't know. I mean, there might be some ways of looking at diversity in society as an end itself. But I think in this context, O'Connor's saying your education is going to be deformed and limited if you don't have that kind of diversity in the community of students and faculty, I would say, that you're in conversation with. And I agree with that. I don't think that stands or falls really with the constitutionality of a particular admissions policy. I guess in that sense, I think of diversity as a means to an end. And I think that's how it's articulated in the college's diversity statement. And I do, to a certain extent, share Caesar's comment. I certainly think, as dean, whatever opinions I might have, I'm obligated to, and wouldn't be in this office if I didn't think it was the right thing to pursue the policy that the faculty has set for the college in that diversity statement. So, of course, no one of us, you know, maps our own thinking directly onto every aspect of, you know, 200 pages of a student handbook and 100 pages of a faculty handbook. We don't have to believe that every word is gospel, but I do think that when the faculty has spoken unanimously and strongly with something like the 2007 diversity statement, and it's held for so long, that of course it can't be all wrong, and I think we have to find the right that's in it. And for me, that's not hard. It seems so intuitive that the education is benefited by these forms of diversity. I guess I sort of alluded to that. The question of affirmative action as a policy, you know, O'Connor herself, right, wrestles with limits to that, and indeed thinks even these forms of it, right, are something like necessary evils, and we should envision a society where they evanesce. And I'm not unsympathetic to that, you know, to that way of looking at it myself. And frankly, I guess I don't, you know, I'm not sure what I think the right constitutional position is. For me, the you know, part of why I love that passage in O'Connor's majority opinion is it kind of rises out of the question of how you settle this as a matter of constitutional law. I think those of us who do think of diversity, including racial diversity, as a value in higher education at this time, and this goes to your opinion piece, has been better brace ourselves for a world where this opinion is reversed. It seems to me as likely as not that it will change, that the constitutional law of the land might change on these kinds of policies. But I don't think the value of those forms of diversity, at least in the horizon of the imaginable, as I see it, is going to go away for the ends of education. So, you know, it'll have to be pursued by good educators in other ways if certain kind of policies maybe are found to be unconstitutional, and maybe for good reason. That's a little beyond my capabilities. Going back to where Mrs. Frank started us, there are weighing tests, very complicated ones here, that the court has to undertake, and that can shift for any number of reasons. Okay,
so I was struck by Justice O'Connor. Her statements about diversity, in many ways, I think she's probably won out on that question of the educational benefits that come from diversity. I think most people, most colleges, the Supreme Court cases that follow tend to follow that line of reasoning when it comes to the educational benefits that come to diversity. And even I was just rereading our statement of the program, I almost could envision the very words in the statement of the program as having been in Justice O'Connor's decision. And these are the words I'm thinking of, by reading great books and struggling together with the fundamental questions that they raise, students and their teachers learn from their differences and discover more deeply their shared humanity. And I hadn't thought of it in those terms before, but those could have been Justice O'Connor's words in this decision, I think.
Well, to challenge us so that we are not in an echo chamber of we need diversity at the table, by stating that we need diversity around the seminar table is one thing, but how it's employed or what that truly means is a very different thing, because you know, we've used diversity in a lot of different ways. I know I've used it multiple different ways tonight, diversity of thought or background or experiences or anything else. And so how do you determine those quotas? And doesn't this just immediately open us up to all sorts of human error? That Ben is saying diversity of this and we need more diversity in the classroom, and I am saying the same thing, but we are thinking completely different things and are implementing admission policies in very different ways. And so how do you dictate what a college needs to do without limiting our spectrum of who we can admit, but then also forgiving the mass human error that we make when we make these types of statements?
Caroline, I'm tempted just to read one line. I mean, I think it's powerful. And in a certain sense, right, O'Connor fully recognizes the risks related to what you said and to the way Thomas puts it here. This is one of Thomas's lines. He says, the absence of any articulated legal principle supporting the majority's principle holding suggests another rationale. This is in section 6 of the dissent. I believe what lies beneath, and this is a really important statement from Thomas, I believe what lies beneath the court's decision today are the benighted notions that one can tell when racial discrimination benefits rather than hurts minority groups. And I think that's one of the critical things, right? Because that's what O'Connor would fully concede. That's the risk. If you have quotas, mechanical quotas, right? She thinks that's gonna lead to deepening racial hostility and racial stereotyping in society. So how you weigh it in a way that reduces, right, the power of stereotypes and discrimination as opposed to exacerbating them. That's a concern that the majority and the dissent share, but Thomas thinks there's a kind of ambition, a hubris to thinking we can get that right in these kinds of policies that I think people should take very seriously. I think if one has the sensation that doing this kind of judging, even in non-mechanical ways, in these balanced, holistic ways, is without risk, I think O'Connor would agree with Thomas. That's an illusion. There's risk. You're running risks. Now, I think that's just as true when we make those kinds of statements I made before about religious diversity, diversity of background. When you say, well, you know, it's this person came from a really, you know, a really tough background and overcame it. All those things we think about in holistic admissions, we're always doing some way, and we're putting people in categories and saying we'd like some more of this in our community, for various reasons. I think there are risks to that of the sort that you and I think Thomas and O'Connor all want to say are there. Maybe it goes to me to, you know, where Ben started. What's the alternative? You come up with one test, and then you have an unequivocal way of saying who's better and worse prepared. And I think almost all of us in this community have tremendous resistance to think that that's the way out of those risks. I suppose, Piér, you might say, and Thomas says this, of course, another way is first come, first serve at all educational institutions or at many. And that's interesting, right? I mean, he talks about that as, in a way, he almost says, once you become selective at all, you're going to back your way in to various kinds of prejudicial ways of trying to balance out effects of that. And So open admissions is, you know, is an interesting thing to think about in that context.
No, I want to appreciate for a moment how the reasoning in the case developed with respect to that argument you just made, Dean Sterling, that we had the original Bakke case, and everybody in the Bakke case seems to have agreed that what was perhaps the original rationale for these types of programs, that is, we're going to do some kind of reparations for poor treatment in the past, was not constitutionally acceptable. In the Bakke case found that. And Justice Powell, in an opinion that nobody else joined, sort of put forward this possibility of diversity as a basis on which these programs could go, these admissions programs could go forward. And then there was a long period, 20 years or something, where nobody really knew, could tell whether Justice Powell's opinion was precedent or whether it, you know, we could, it should be ignored in favor of the agreement that these programs were kind of dubious constitutionally. And what this case did, among all the other things it did, was to say, we're not going to answer the question that we were asked, that is Justice Powell's opinion in Bakke precedent, because we're going to endorse it with a 5-person majority. So whatever it used to be, it's precedent now. And I think it's a really interesting development to think about, because the goal of diversity based on an express rejection of any notion that we're trying to say, oh, people have been poorly treated in the past, therefore we give them a benefit now. Thomas is simply saying, I don't believe that. You haven't given me the evidence that that's how you really feel. So I believe that you're secretly doing reparations, which is unconstitutional. That's the kind of linchpin of his argument. So, and I don't know how to address a sort of situation where somebody is just saying, well, that's not what you're really doing. You're secretly doing something else. I don't know how to me, it seems very possible that somebody sincerely believes that diversity is valuable for a community. And it puts things on a really interesting footing, because it's no longer individual merit. It's the institution building its own community. And the applicants are asking to be included in that community. And the institution is saying, here are the ones we think will make the community we want. And the other people may be perfectly capable of doing the work in a vacuum, as someone put it, but are not part of the community we want. This is what I was trying to express earlier when I was thinking that merit has really been left behind with this particular rationale for these admissions programs.
I think I'm going to read the next question, which follows up on Mr. Cervantes' point, as it says, and this is from Mr. Cornell. How can this nation begin to address the extreme inequalities in K-12 education, given the way property determines the quality of particular school districts? And I don't know that he meant that was directed at you necessarily, Mr. Cervantes, but you did bring that up, I think, as part of a constellation of public policy and political questions that intersect, and you didn't want to, you know, deal with the narrow context of this constitutional question apart from them. So do you have thoughts about that? And surely it's something everyone on the panel, every thoughtful person in our country thinks about this.
Yeah, you know, my opinions here would be quite anecdotal. And, you know, my experience is in student life. And, you know, but I think my point was that these are intertwined, right? And so we're looking at a particular case, but the reason we're looking at one of the reasons we're looking at a particular case is influenced by multiple factors. And one of those factors happens to be what we're doing in K-12. And as you've pointed out, there's a direct relationship between this sort of socioeconomic piece of who gets a certain kind of education and why. And so I think my response would be that it's a problem, and I hope to engage locally and think that way. And that's kind of been my thinking about it. And I'm learning, you know, that's where I'm at on this particular issue.
I mean, and to you know, I don't know what to do about K-12, but what the pressing way that presents itself to us at St. John's is that we get students who have had very diverse, by which I mean, you know, varying in preparation in terms of their education, and then they all come into the program. And I think every tutor feels a bit this tension of, well, I have some students who have had, you know, AP calculus and a lot of algebra, and I have some students who haven't. Now they're all here. How do we, what's our responsibility towards that? And the faculty often discusses that in terms of, we used to assume we could count on this people already coming knowing this, but we find that now we have to teach it. And so the faculty, I think, is always thinking about that. But I think maybe we have to think seriously about what's our responsibility, given what we know, maybe differences in educational background, and given that we accept that difference in part because of the sense that they will bring diversity of perspective, of experience to the college. So I don't know, that's a pressing question for me.
That's a much better framing, Guillermo, and actually it gets me thinking that, right, so how do we bring it here knowing what we know? So rather than sort of trying to say, this is a problem that we can't solve, what do we do with that information? We have to increase our resources, right? And so, you know, when we look at our Bridge program, for example, that launched this year, that's one of the ways in which we can do that. And we have to get creative and innovative as a small college with limited resources. But I think that's exactly right. How do we take this as sort of accept this and work with what we know?
Piér, I wonder if you have anything you want to add, again, thinking about, you know, the context of a community college, for example, and its mission or anything else.
I think this is the question that has come up at every institution I've ever worked for, which is this, the under-preparation that we see in terms of students entering our classrooms because they may not have received the type of education needed for them to enter college level classes. And so I think in recent years, I've seen a shift away from the question of blaming K-12, so to speak, but saying, how do we begin to meet students where they are when they enter our institutions? And what resources can we provide to help them succeed, right? So I think oftentimes we're having to look at the different barriers that may be in students' way, or looking at them as coming with the deficit as opposed to our systems being the problem, and not the student themselves, and always trying to fix the student. It's how can we fix our system so that our students can thrive in this new environment and learn in a way that maybe they haven't been exposed to in the past. And so I think that anymore, I do see a shift in how higher ed institutions are thinking about the K-12 challenge when they walk in our doors, of thinking, what is it that we need to do to help them to be successful in our institution in this environment? And again, the Bridge program is a good example of one way of trying to do that work ahead of time. But yeah, I think it's definitely a complicated problem because it's layered. Right, it's layered. It starts pre-K, K through 12, higher ed. And so there's just a lot of work to do overall. And so if we could think about ways in which we can address it at St. John's, say, I think that's what we can do in the meantime. And then, like Cesar mentioned earlier, how do you become more involved in the community to help support K through 12 education or to understand it better? So that, I guess, that would be my like impression of where it is today.
It's interesting how we all encounter this problem, I think, from our own vantage point from what we do at the college. And so, you know, this case is about the admissions process, but in fact, Caroline and I encounter this question of K through 12 disparities even earlier when we're doing the recruitment process. And one of the things we've charged all the people we work with in admissions to do is, as we recruit, as we go and travel, or this year as we do virtual travel, that we reach out to high schools where we haven't always enrolled students, where there are large numbers of underrepresented students, under-resourced communities, who might not know about St. John's. And a great example of this was just from this week. I'm in Washington, D.C., trying to reach out to high schools, and an elite, private, expensive high school in D.C. rejected my offer to come in and do their program because they had already filled up all of their spots. And they have about 2 spots every day for the months of September, October, and November. So basically every college in the country wanted to come and visit this school. Meanwhile, I did a program at a public charter school in DC. And I did the program. And at the end of it, I said, you must be really busy. You probably have a lot more of these to do. And I was told, actually, they only had 40 colleges sign up, only 40 over the course of those 3 months. And so on the one hand, you have this private school with hundreds of colleges trying to do their students, and another with just 40 that have done that. And this is another place you're seeing this sort of disparity, and it calls attention to the kind of work that we need to do in all different places in the college in order to help address the disparity.
You know what? I was thinking about what somebody was, I guess it was the dean, saying earlier about how, with all kinds of caution, suggesting that interest may be at least among the most important things that we look for in an applicant, as opposed to, you know, measures of ability from SATs and so forth. And maybe that focus has a role to play in helping things to get better nationally. Because I'm thinking about it, I taught music last year. And in the topic of music, you have exactly the same variation in preparation. Some people have played piano all their lives, and some people had never sat down to it and knew nothing. But it didn't have the same kind of onerous feeling about that calculus does. It felt more like preference and interest. And so the challenge of putting together a class that worked over that wide range didn't have as much of a sense of, oh, I don't know this stuff and other people do. There was more a shared exploration into what music is. And the naive reaction was valuable to the conversation, and the sophisticated reaction was valuable to the conversation. And putting together conversations like that is something that I would like to think St. John's does well and prides itself on. And so maybe we have a little niche here in these circumstances.
I might make a comment on that, but I'm just going to say right now we don't have other questions queued up, so I'd love to we're prepared to go a bit longer for anyone who wants to stay, and I'd love to hear a question if anybody wants to raise their hand or type in another question. While we're waiting, I was just going to say on that point, I know for me, and again, I'm not claiming to be an expert here, but I think what I'm about to say is widely accepted economic. data. For me, one of the really jarring facts to absorb in recent years has been that I think the increasing evidence that the socioeconomic stratum that you're born into is more highly predictive of where you're going to end up than it used to be. And that seems very closely correlated to the question of whether education is creating social mobility, the ability to rise economically in the ways that it used to. And I think the evidence is it's not. And that seems to me to be locked into these K through 12 questions, but also the way in which that then sorts so powerfully for whether you go to college and where you go to college and what you get out of it and so on. So I don't know, I guess this is another place where I think it's not really, it barely can be discovered as a political divide, the anxiety that we have and should have when we see economic caste systems start to get more concretized rather than less. And it seems to me that's a lot of the spirit of what O'Connor is talking about, the power that education has to create a democratic citizenry that's really allowing people to be individuals that can pursue different paths competently, but partly because they're put in contact, right, with all sorts and conditions of people in this society, and they have opportunities that go past maybe what some of the more mechanical wickets that could be put in place for folks would be. But as far as a remedy for the K through 12 problem, it's a profound one, the relationship between educational resources and the value of the home you happen to own. I suppose that system can be defended, but it's tough on its face.
On the flip side, Walter, or maybe just I feel compelled to say what we all know, but the deeper we get into these conversations, this feeling comes up. And I have to say, it is not the case, of course, that all minoritized students are underqualified, right? And so we should just make note of that, I think, because as we deepen into these conversations, we start that thinking of, well, this is the system in place because of X, Y, and Z. But that can be dangerous, right? Because then in within your community, if you're carrying that sort of bias with you, it can be damaging to students who are coming into the community. And so just want to put that out there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's an important reminder. And the discussions do often slip in to some mapping there. I was thinking in relation to the K through 12 that it really swallows up in some ways the race questions, because I think it's as true for, if I'm not mistaken, for white Americans as it is for, I think that more strongly predictive character of the household income that you're born into, where you're going to end up, and that, you know, that hits poor communities that are not minority communities, I think just as hard. There are things coming, and maybe they were there and I didn't see them. It's non-trivial to try to keep track of everything here. Okay, to Piér, how do we provide the resources you spoke of to such students without what some would call dumbing down the program? So they're speaking specifically to the St. John's context, I think.
Yeah, I would say, I think this kind of fits in with Cesar's point of not all minoritized students are underqualified, but for those who may be underprepared, I think this idea of dumbing down the program or lowering standards or expectations, I think there's a lot of research that supports the idea of maintaining your standards so that, because students can achieve them. but they need to, there may be some stepping stones. So for example, there's a writing there are writing assistants, right? There's Mr. Bauman, who provides writing support. There's the bridge program that's providing support. These are things that are kind of like the building blocks for folks who may be struggling more, but the idea isn't to lower the standard or the expectation because they can meet it. It's just, how can we help them along the way to get there? And so I think that that's something that's really important not to forget. Maintain the standards, because we know that students can achieve them. For some of them, it just may be a bit more challenging.
I mean, as a faculty, you know, as someone in the classroom, I've often wondered if the faculty also needs to think about the entry point into the college beyond something like the bridge program. For instance, I've often had the experience of discovering in a seminar oral for the first time all that's really going on in a student's head, but that because we also have the quiet student, who's another kind of student that it doesn't correspond to minority or not, but it's a kind of student who faces a challenge that other students don't face. And then the oral comes, and then I think all this stuff is going on, but it's not visible in the class. At some level, this person is not fully strictly doing the program the way we'd want to, but then they discover something in the one-on-one conversation, and that has sometimes led me to think maybe there should be more of a one slow one-on-one engagement with texts and students at the beginning of the program, even if it means slowing down the path through some part of it. So I don't know, I'm thinking out loud, and this isn't something I would propose, but I just think there it's not just a matter of dumbing down, or it sometimes when you can slow things down to the point where it's interesting at whatever level you are, but it allows those who are less familiar with the pace of a certain kind of education to join it. So I don't know, I think that it's something also for the faculty to consider, is how do we bring people on board? You know, and sometimes the most, you know, sophisticated students need a version of that too, because they just, you know, they'll talk too much and think they know everything, and they need their own kind of, like, you know, moment of coming on board. So I don't know, I think there could be creative ways to think about approaches that make people feel like they have more of an entryway into something that otherwise can feel overwhelmingly fast or collective, or, you know, as a thought. I mean, I thought this question isn't just on Pierre. This is the question we all have to grapple with.
Well, I do think we have a little bit of a advantage here, because the great books, you can't do dumb versions of them. I mean, when people engage with them, they're engaging with the best. So we're not in a position where that many schools are, where they say, well, look, our fourth graders are reading at a third grade level, we better give them third grade textbooks and graduate them from fourth grade. And that's the kind of fear that people have, when you're talking about dumbing down stuff. But we're just trying to provide a ramp to the best that there is.
Yeah, I think in the spirit of that, I don't know, there's so many ways that I can make this point, but I just think the college has been so committed to blowing up the idea from its inception of a kind of single axis from worse to better of students. I mean, I'm tempted to offer very provocative, well, at least to my mind, maybe provocative formulations, but I think they're true of the college. I think the college understands the program as, or the risk in education as more tied to facile intelligence and its pretensions to competence, for example, than to dumbing down. I mean, there's so many ways we reflect that. I think if to the degree to which you think, and there's something to this, that a student with high test scores, high school GPA, maybe getting all A's for a couple of years at St. John's, you might be able to predict that student is going to have an easier time working through some calculus problems in junior math, or in the work that's predicated on the calculus in junior and senior math and lab. And somebody might be tempted to say, if we could only have a class of those students, think of what we could accomplish. But I think, and this goes back to Ms. Brand's comment, I think the college has been deeply committed to the view that that would be an inferior education for those students, because there'd be a facile character to what they do. And that actually the heterogeneity of intellectual angles of approach, some of which we might identify with students who struggle, but most of the faculty believe that some of the students who struggle ask the questions that blow up the pseudo-intellectual momentum that some of the smarter students might get going with. Now, that doesn't mean that everything's on the side of those struggling students, right? But you want all that heterogeneity. It doesn't map on to one axis. That's what the college is so invested in. And you could say the whole case hinges on the question of whether we can have these simple quantitative metrics that line everybody up from short to tall, and then decide how many of them we you know, how far down we want to go or something like that. But so all educators recognize that that's a false ideal. But I think what the college embraces that goes further is the idea that the people who are strong in some of those ways are genuinely going to be weak in others, and the people who are weak in some of those ways are going to be strong in others. And you better have all of that in the classroom, otherwise you're going to miss what's most powerful about this kind of work. Okay, let's go, because we do have other questions coming in. Isn't there an implicit trade-off with a ratio? So this is good. I think we're getting a challenge from Thomas's perspective, because to go back to the earlier question, the last thing we want at St. John's is to put together a group that then gets caught in its own echo chamber, which certainly was not our intention here. Isn't there an implicit trade-off with a racially based admissions policy that the educational benefits of a diverse student body are seen as more important than admitting the most capable and competitive students? Might such a policy result in turning away those who would agree with Mr. Thomas's dissenting opinion? Is racial diversity more important than thought diversity? Does anybody wanna lead the way?
Go ahead.
No, Ben, actually, I was just going to say, you know, our admission folks are probably going to be right on this, but I think it goes back to your question about what is merit, how do we choose merit, who's determining merit, et cetera. And then, you know, thought and racial diversity aren't necessarily mutually exclusive, right?
Yeah, I agree. You said it for me. I mean, I think that question of merit, I mean, there's a false assumption that somehow these things are in conflict with each other. They are in conflict with each other if you've chosen the way you're going to admit students as to be the best test scores or the best grades, then they could be in conflict. But if you've set up a holistic process like the one we use at St. John's, where we're looking for students with interest in what we do, who are excited to thrive in this program, it might not be a test score that is indicative of that success to come. And so those things then aren't in tension. We need to admit students who might not have the best test scores, but offer something different to the discussion that's happening in the classroom. And so I'd argue that that tension doesn't really exist if you've built a genuine holistic admissions process where we aren't just valuing one metric like a test score over everything else. And I also think it's important to note, and I think this was in Justice O'Connor's decision, that this case is all about race, because that is something in the Constitution that we are told not to base government action upon. I mean, that is the reason we're talking about race. But actually, affirmative action is kind of a misnomer. It doesn't, it's not really about race, those words, affirmative action. You don't hear the word race in there. You admit students all the time based on characteristics that aren't test scores or aren't grades. You like the ideas that they're expressing in an essay they've written in the admissions process. Maybe at another college, they play a sport exceptionally well. They have some qualities that we see that we want as a part of our community. And those aren't often the result of a test score or a grade. It just so happens this case is focused on that question of race because that's a thorny issue in our constitution and in our society. But race is actually just one of many characteristics that aren't a test score or grades that we might be considering in the admissions process.
So let me just try to reflect back what I hear both of you saying, which seemed to me in keeping with what the dean was saying, that if we chose one metric, and you know, an obvious one is SATs or grade point average, nice numerical metrics, and we decided to define that as most capable and competitive, that's what that means, is high on that metric, then we would have a homogeneous student body who would have a worse education than if we had this holistic approach with a variety of difficultly put together metrics. that's the claim.
Or I might say at least we might, and every college and university should, or I mean, I'm thinking about what Caroline said earlier. It's not clear there's one remedy, you know, to get everything right that applies to every place. But what I would say is if you see that the effect of that is going to be to generate this skew that impoverishes the education that your students are able to get, then you're going to come up with ways to complement that or subordinate it. I mean, I think St. John's has always radically subordinated those to, you know, to other things, but we still, of course, you know, take them into consideration. But at other places, it seems like the situation for Michigan trying to be an elite selective law school, and we know that the professional schools operate this way largely mechanically, at least the data suggests that, based on test scores and GPA. And so the question is, how much freedom do they have to improve the education rather than just let what comes out, let what falls out of that? And I would say that, again, in the context of wanting the education to do what we want it to do, the kinds of goals that O'Connor lays out, if the effect of that metric is racial homogeneity or socioeconomic homogeneity or political homogeneity, or I mean any of these things that are really going to narrow you know, the horizon of experience and discourse or reinforce, right, the stereotypes that will echo around in that, you know, in that more homogenous community, that all of those outcomes seem problematic. But I would also say, so I mean, what I hear you all saying, and I agree with this, the premise of the question is it's a zero-sum game, and you're going to win on one side at the expense of the other. There's a pie of weighting that's being divvied up here, say between racial diversity and thought diversity. And we don't accept that. I don't think anybody here accepts that. But if we're with O'Connor, we understand that there are forms of pursuing diversity, racial or otherwise, that would have the negative effects that Thomas is concerned about, right? O'Connor and Thomas are going to agree that if you set up a school and say, we want exactly 20% to be this, 10% to be that, 70% to be that, that it's going to, at least for some individuals, it's going to deepen and foster stereotypes, hostilities, et cetera. I mean, we might not all agree with that, but I think the premise of the case is there are ways of pursuing diversity that would be at the expense of the educational aims and would deepen rather than alleviate the very problems that, you know, that you might be seeking to overcome. And I myself agree with that. I myself agree that the court's standard of strict scrutiny and the way in which that has rendered unconstitutional certain forms of quota systems, I think is to the advantage of becoming becoming a society more free of stereotypes and more credibly endorsing of individual freedom and accomplishment that's not under the shadow of some of those mechanical regimes. And it might be that some of you disagree with that, but I just want to point out that it's a shared premise of the majority opinion and a feature of constitutional law that there are forms of pursuing diversity that would have something like the zero sum or counterproductive effects, but that we seem to be exploring space where we think it's not an either or. There might be a balancing, but there's a both and. That's precisely what you're aiming at, and my own experience supports that. As I think O'Connor says at some point, what does she say? Experience, she has some phrase, tradition and experience, or experience and evidence, support this view.
I think there's two separate arguments too, right? Because there's I think if we split this up, it's sort of like, are we happy with the status quo? And if that's the position, then that's a separate argument. If we're not happy with the status quo and it's not optimal, that's fine, right? But then the conversation continues as to how to optimize the goals that we wish to meet.
Okay, shall I take another question? I see that we had one. Okay, I'm gonna do them in order. From Randall Hollinsby. Hello, Randall. Is the 25-year barrier less about how long racism will last and more about how long it might take to train admissions offices to rethink their policies? I'll just note before hearing from others on the panel, it just because this might not be obvious to everybody, it had been 25 years from the Bakke ruling to this ruling. And unless somebody sees something else, I think O'Connor picked that number a little bit arbitrarily, just to frame, as a kind of symmetry there. I don't think there was a case for why it would be 25 rather than 20 or 30, but forecasting the next time the court might take it up, just as now they were taking it up 25 years after Bakke. That said, I think if she thought it were wildly inappropriate, she wouldn't have used it. So that's an aside. So just let me read it again. Is the 25-year barrier less about how long racism will last and more about how long it might take to train admissions offices to rethink their policies? Thoughts on that?
Well, I like the question a lot because it sort of reinforces for me my sense of the radical difference between a goal of racial quota systems of, having representation or something, and a diversity goal. That is to say that admissions officers are no longer using race as a stand-in for diversity, but have to think in terms of real diversity, with this wider set of considerations that Mr. Baum was mentioning. So I like the question, and I hope it's so.
I might take it to a different way of approaching the question is not necessarily the reality of what Justice O'Connor was saying, but what happens next. That's one of the things that has me anxious. I think the reality is we're in a danger zone right now. We're coming up on 25 years in this case. We have a Supreme Court majority now that Justice Kennedy has left the court, where it's hard to imagine they are supportive of race-conscious affirmative action, although they haven't yet ruled as this constituted Supreme Court on that question. And while the Supreme Court is loath to just to just uproot its earlier decisions and to say they were wrong and to say something different. They don't really have to if they can point back to Justice O'Connor and say, well, it's been 25 years. and there are things, I think, beyond the 25-year mark that might give them latitude to make a decision like that, where they could purport to follow the rules we see here in Grutter and yet come to a very different conclusion about affirmative action going forward. And that's something I have on my mind.
Ben, I'm curious, Ben and Carolyn, would your job, I mean, I thought in part Randall's question suggests once a certain kind of way of thinking about a situation establishes itself, that may be the main thing that needs to happen as opposed to a legal injunction. Because I thought the dissenting opinions are basically saying you're doing what you were doing before with quotas, you're just hiding it. And then I think, well, say the ruling changed, would it affect your day-to-day work at the college very intensely, or have certain patterns of thinking about college with regards to society and race establish themselves such that colleges would continue to employ a certain, the criteria that have been formed over the last 20 years or so, regardless of, you know, the ruling?
Do you want to take that, Colin? Do you want me to?
I mean, I just very simply, I think from a St. John's standpoint, I don't think it impacts us if it changes one way or the other. You know, we are not at the point of, you know, Harvard and Michigan where we are giving extra points for individuals from certain races or from certain backgrounds or ethnicities. And so if it changes tomorrow, our process still stays the same. In trying to find the right fit for St. John's and trying to recruit a very diverse population from all different backgrounds. But I can absolutely see it having some massive effects from a more national standpoint at these different colleges that are elite and forcing them to change. But I also think it allows us to then go back and look at a lot of these other merit criteria that we've been talking about. And if everything changes and we have to go back and look at SAT and class rank and things like that only, then it brings up all sorts of other problems.
It's interesting that it seems to me the testing regime has never been in sort of more disarray and losing more ground than it is right now for a variety of reasons. Some related to this, but many unrelated to these considerations. You know, it also occurred to me in thinking about the broader social and political shifts around this. We have multiple criteria from our accrediting bodies that hold us to standards of diversity. Again, you could say the language comes right out of the O'Connor opinion. You know, how well the college prepares students for life in a diverse society and, you know, in a range diversity in our own community. And it's never narrowly defined as race, but I would say the accreditors and the federal government understand race in the array of diversity considerations that we're being held accountable for, and we have to pursue those ends in good faith. And if not, we shouldn't pursue accreditation, and we shouldn't accept federal financial aid that's predicated on it. And of course, there are institutions, right, who want to be that, you know, that free from those broader national standards. But St. John's has never pursued that degree of freedom from those national expectations.
Well, I do want to bring us back to a point that Mr. Baum made, that race is a particular quality that mentioned specifically in the Constitution. And my guess is that other measures of diversity would be untouched, even if this case were overturned. Now, then there'll be a pile of litigation where people are accusing people of using other types of diversity as a proxy for race, but I think it might not have a huge effect on those diversity requirements that you mentioned.
Right, and this might, I think I might be repeating things that were just said about Randall's question, but of course some people might say, and I doubt that this is at all the consensus view of this call. It's not, I don't think it's what I'd say, but I think it captures a significant piece of the truth. Someone might say, we're only interested in race as a proxy for other forms of diversity, namely intellectual, spiritual, however you want to think about it. That it's a way at that. Many leaders in various kinds of organizations, many business leaders, quickly, right? Talk that way because of how simply they want to digest things. You want diversity of these different sorts because you want diversity of opinion, because diversity of opinion is going to drive your quest to get better outcomes, to get to the truth, and so on. But I bring it up in this context to say, if you had to circumnavigate race as a category, you might find other ways to get at the diversity of thought you're after. But presumably, anyone who's using race as a factor thinks that that's a good clue for the kind of mix that we want or need to have. And it might turn out to be quite hard to find clues as good as race or religion or socioeconomic background, nationality, political opinions, and so on. Okay, I see one more question. I think I'm gonna suggest maybe this is our last question, and then we'll just see if anybody on the panel has some closing thoughts. From Bill Blaze, in some sense, disparities might be addressed by programs. And so this is thinking about the college, I think, and the disparities of preparation, perhaps, that students bring, or resources, by programs involving the broader community. The Student Committee on Instruction used to be involved in creating tutoring connections, partly with the conviction that providing support is also an opportunity for service for the top half of disparities, another way in which diversity might serve the broader community. I'll just offer the thought that for sure we help one another. I was suggesting in the classroom context before that we all help each other. And some, you might say, some who are poor in some ways are rich in others, and that's almost a law of nature. And we see it in our classroom and in our community. And we might do better and worse at tapping into that to pull one another along in various ways. Something about the way the question was framed, triggers my St. John's egalitarian spidey sense. I don't think we have too many things that are set up where we say, top half, get on this side of the room, bottom half on this side, about much of anything, intellectual ability, financial resources. And, so we're going to partner up one-to-one. Let's see. He says, did I really say top half? You did. Maybe. I'm not trying to make fun of your question, Bill. I'm trying to get more to the heart of it. So I guess I would just say I affirm the spirit of it, but maybe I would frame it a bit differently. And I do think that we see those kinds of efforts, both organized and not. Around campus. I certainly think of the academic assistance program, which is much bigger now and much more widely utilized now, though it existed when I was a student, for example, as a version of what Bill's talking about. But others might have very different reactions to the question, so I'm sorry I hijacked it a little bit. Other folks have thoughts about the way the community itself can help one another in addressing, and the student community can in addressing needs and disparities that students show up with.
Maybe I misunderstood the question. I thought this was about tutoring in the broader community, that is to say, Santa Fe or Annapolis. Is that not right?
I think you're right, Martha. I think I just sort of misread it. I was thinking about how we're talking about our students showing up with different, but now that I reread it, Bill's right there, so maybe you can clarify. did Mrs. Franks get it right, Bill? Now I think maybe you did, or maybe he means both. But yeah, tutoring in the community. And of course, we've had those kinds of efforts ongoing over the years. I think your reading's right. And I think we probably would all embrace that as important for any number of reasons for our students to find opportunities to give back and help other students not here at the college maybe find their way forward educationally.
I'll add, this is still going on. So we work with a number of students who are tutoring in the community through different organizations. And I would say that the educational benefits of students who aren't necessarily from here, who are going into the schools in our communities, are definitely learning a lot about education, maybe about educational disparities that exist in K-12 education, income disparities, that sort of thing. And so I think it is a powerful experience for our Johnnies who are going out and working with students. And many of them may have come from similar backgrounds. And so it's their way of giving back and serving as role models to say, you know, here are some opportunities for you when you leave here, right? St. John's is down the road, you may not have considered it. So a lot of really positive things happen, or at least that I observe, when students are able to do that within our community here in Santa Fe.
And of course, there's no field, if you construe it broadly, K-12 and higher education, there's no field that attracts more of our alumni than education. So somehow that is as a sense of calling. It's not uncommon. It somehow fits the education. Does anyone on the panel, I'm not going to ask us to go around just in the name of time, but I'm certainly not in a rush myself. Does anybody on the panel want to offer any kind of closing thoughts before we wind up?
Well, I'd very much like to thank anyone who deserves thanks for giving me the occasion to read this case and think seriously about it and these extraordinarily difficult issues. I mean, I guess I could say this. We think about it in terms of our admissions policies at St. John's, which is perfectly appropriate. But one perhaps really large issue from the point of view of people outside of education has to do with the merely legal question of what exactly the government should be doing. So I hear in Thomas's dissent the position, very respectable position, look, it might be wonderful to have diversity on campuses, that might be a better education, but should the government really be putting its whole force behind that? Very reasonable question. So I think that just in terms of looking at what the case is about, maybe that should be mentioned.
Any other remarks? Well, I want to say a couple things before we end officially. First, I want to thank all of the panelists for joining me today. And, you know, we're trying, I didn't say this at the beginning, I'll say it now at the end, this is one of those contexts where we're trying to take advantage of we're trying to make a virtue of necessity with having these events online and available to more of our community and trying different, you know, different formats. And I think having a panel that cut across the kind of work and engagement that we all do at the college. I've been energized, looking forward to it, and I appreciate all of you participating. I thank the audience for attending, and I want to mention that we have another, until the technology crashes, another very good event coming this Friday with musician in residence and longtime tutor, Peter Pesek, providing a concert and conversation. He's got a longer title, but broadly speaking, connects music and science. And then a week from Friday, nested into our alumni week, our sort of virtual homecoming week this year, we have a tutor panel, Mr. Carl, Mr. McDonald, Mr. Venkatesh, who will be speaking on photography. And that's the culmination of a year-long faculty study group that they were involved in. So I'm excited by the kind of events, the range of events, and the range of formats that we're using. So please join us for those. And I think I'm not going to try to offer any wise words, except this kind of conversation shows me how even with quite current, right, political things, we can have very engaged and very connected conversations that come out of our experience at the college, relate to what we do here, but also put us in dialogue with what's going on in the wider world and within our own community around complicated political, social, legal issues of the day or of the age. So that's part of what was on my mind today, and I'm satisfied that we reminded ourselves that that's part of our work too. So thank you all. And
thank you.
With that, we'll close.
Thanks, Walter. Thanks all.
Thanks all. Good night.